guys, welcome back to Pepper Geek. A little while back, we had you guys ask us some questions for a Q&A video, and we are finally getting around to answering some of them for you.
It's not the time of year to be growing plants right now. It's about 32 degrees out there, but it's a good time to go through some questions and get prepared for the spring. Okay, so jumping right in, our first question is, what should I do to the soil before planting? And that was asked by Christian. I'll break this into two parts. The first will be in-ground, and then we'll talk about potted plants. So for in-ground beds, we start amending the soil about 2 weeks before plants are gonna be going outside. And you can start by forking the soil. We don't really like tilling the soil unless it's your first garden bed. Then you can till and do sort of a deep dig. But for established beds and raised beds that you've had for a while, you can just fork the soil with a broad fork or just a pitchfork, just to loosen it up a little bit. And then definitely add some compost if you have some. You can make it yourself or you can get it locally. A lot of towns will offer free or cheap compost. Just rake that into the first few inches of the soil and you should be good to go. If you don't have access to compost, you can use slow release fertilizer. Just use the recommended amount by the manufacturer of the fertilizer you choose. And those are really the only things we do to the soil for in-ground plants. For potted plants, it can be a little bit different. If you're buying brand new soil, you may not need to do anything except for fertilize regularly throughout the season. Potted plants can lose nutrients over time as the water washes them out. So we just do a regular fertilizing regimen for potted plants.
All right, so our next question is from The Bandit, and they asked, what are some top-notch reputable seed sellers and how do you know that they're the right seeds? So we have used many different seed retailers. We actually have a post about our favorite places to buy seeds, which we will link to below. Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds at rareseeds.com. They have a great reputation, and you can get more than peppers there. You can get anything, vegetables, flowers. We've never had issues with their seeds not being true to type. Another great retailer is White Hot Peppers. They are US-based. They have a lot of great super hot varieties that are open pollinated, so you might want to check out there as well. And we also really like Semillas La Palma if you're looking for any unique super hot varieties, though they can take a little bit longer than you might expect to come in the mail.
Yeah, they're overseas. I think they're based out of the Canary Islands. So
yeah,
they have a ton of different varieties, and they also have some cool pubescent species peppers, the Rocotos, so definitely some unique things there.
But we'll leave a link below to all of the seed retailers that we recommend. We keep it up to date.
Our next question comes from Wes Whirl, and they ask, are pepper crosses more likely to pick up traits from the male or the female plant? This question is regarding crossbreeding plants. So when you pollinate one plant to another plant, the one that donates the pollen is the male plant, and the one that receives the pollen is the female plant. So they're basically asking, which one should I choose when I'm crossbreeding? And the answer is always to cross both ways. You want to make both plants, the male and the female, and try to get a cross on both plants and see which one sticks. Sometimes you'll get both, so which one should you choose? And the only thing I've really ever heard is that if you're looking for a more vigorous plant, if one of the plants you're crossing has more vigorous growth, it grows faster and larger, make that one the female if you're gonna choose one over the other. Otherwise, it really shouldn't make that much of a difference. They should share 50-50 genetics.
All right, so our next question comes from J.R. Trevino, and they asked, what is your favorite spicy food recipe, if you have one? To be honest, I mean, we cook, almost all of our meals are really spicy. We add hot sauce to all of them, and it's hard to narrow down just one because it changes all the time, but we have been cooking a lot from this book, Fresh India. And we'll leave a link in the description for this book, as well as some of the recipes we really enjoy from it. A lot of them utilize fresh chilies. We usually add a little bit extra to make it spicier. They're all vegetarian recipes too, but this book has been great.
Just want to note, I think it's also the perfect name for the book because all of the meals are so fresh tasting. They use like fresh cilantro and fresh chilies, and it just tastes so good.
Yeah, they're really delicious, and we'll link to it below. And then we do have a recipe for spicy chili that we've been working on, and we're probably going to do a video on that pretty soon, so stay tuned for that.
Next up, I think this is probably the most important question we have on this list, and that is, what are some tips for attracting beneficial insects? A lot of people, when you see a pest problem, your first response is to try to kill off all the pests. But in doing that, a lot of times you end up killing the beneficial insects that are there trying to eat those pests for you. So it's a lot better to try to attract the beneficial insects to your garden and have them take care of your pest problem. And basically there are two ways to do this. One is to plant a variety of other plants. especially flowers. Most of the beneficial insects you want to attract are pollen or nectar feeders, so they're looking for flowers. And a few of the flowers you can plant are alyssums. Those are really good for attracting the minute pirate bug, which eats a lot of different things, like aphids, spider mites, thrips. And alyssums also attract parasitic wasps, which sounds scary, but they won't sting you. They're really just there to lay their eggs in things like aphids. Another great bug to see around is the green lacewing. And to attract those, you can plant cosmos, daisies, and yarrow. All of those flowers will attract the lacewings. And the other thing you can do if you have a really bad infestation is to first look for beneficial insects. If you see aphids, try to look among the aphids and look for larvae of beneficial insects. If you see tiny little white rice-like looking things, those are actually hoverfly larvae, and they will hatch soon and start eating aphids. So you don't really have to go spraying them with insecticidal soap. That will kill off the hoverfly larvae and your problem will only get worse.
You can also attract ladybugs by using a ladybug house or by making sure that they have enough water available. You always want to attract the local beneficial insects as opposed to purchasing them if possible.
And I'd also just recommend looking up what flowers grow natively in your area. There's no sense in trying to attract a bug that doesn't exist in your area, so by planting native flowers, you're going to attract the natural insects and predators that exist around you.
So our last question comes from 79 Poison Breaker, and they asked, what peppers would be best to season a chili for people that can't handle the heat? Love the pepper flavors, but we can't do hot. So the first pepper that really comes to mind is the habanero pepper. You get all of the habanero flavor without the heat that comes along with it. Another great option is the poblano pepper if you're looking for peppers to grow. Ancho chilies are actually dried poblano peppers, so that's the main ingredient in chili powder, and they do a great job at making any dish a little bit more flavorful without the crazy heat.
Bell peppers are not to be overlooked. They're sweet, and there are so many different varieties of bell peppers out there. You don't get very many off of each plant, but they're sweet and tasty, and you can find some that are disease resistant and won't be problematic in the garden.
Yeah, the Lesia pepper is pretty good too. That's nice and sweet. It's a thick-walled pepper, and it was pretty prolific for us.
We got quite a few.
Yeah.
It's basically a bell pepper, but it looks kind of interesting, like sort of this large teardrop shape.
Yeah, it's a little bit sweeter too, so it might help with adding that sweetness profile to a dish if you're looking for that.
So I think that's it for this video. We might do this again. If you have additional questions about growing peppers or anything pepper-related, leave them in the comments below and we'll be sure to look through them.
Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time.